Welcome to Storytime with Papa Henry. We are reading Captain Daly's Crew and the Long-Eared Taxicab by Craig Massey. This chapter is entitled The Little Old Man. Wonder who that will be. The next 3 days were interesting. We spent most of our time at the Jameson camp, except when the Long-Eared Taxicab was bringing supplies up the 2 mile trail, or busy carrying down tents and cots and duffel. Jennifer Petronella was sure a docile donkey and always good for a laugh, especially when she'd stop on the trail to sleep a while. Each time she did, we'd always see whether we could push her into action, but it never worked. Jennifer, I don't mean the donkey, I mean Jennifer Jameson, spent most of her time half whining about the camp or the flies or the smoke from the fire or about her namesake, the donkey. She never really acted friendly to us at all. On Saturday morning, we arrived at camp to discover Jennifer Jameson painting on a square of heavy cardboard. I started to ease over to take a look at to see what she was doing when Mr. Jameson jumped on me. "Young man, don't you dare go near that child! She has the temperament of a true artist, and if you disturb her, the picture would be ruined." Wow. I figured that Jenny should be a pretty good artist, for she sure was temperamental. So I waited until she was finished, and then asked, "May I see it now?" "Yes, you may," she replied, as chilly as an air-cooled 5 and 10 on a hot August day. When I looked at it, I sure couldn't see anything worth getting temperamental about. It was supposed to be the lake down below us, fringed about with the balsam fir, and then for a background, the towering mountains. I honestly felt that a 6-year-old girl could do near as good, but I didn't say anything. You should have heard Mrs. Jameson when she looked at it. "Exquisite, darling, exquisite! The blend of colors, the balance, there's no doubt about your improvement. This is the work of a genius." And the girl drank it all in with a real satisfied expression on her face. The first one I'd seen there, but not the kind I liked to see. Poor Pudge. Walked up about that time, took one look at the picture, and croaked, "Jumping pumpkin seeds! What is it?" That did it. Jennifer landed a solid slap on Pudge's cheek. What a sight! A furious girl and a bewildered boy.
"All I said was, what is it? I just wanted to know, honest," Pudge blurted. You, twin brother to that gruesome beast! Oh, father! This is the end! I demand that you take me home this instant!"
Mrs. Jameson chimed in.
"Really, John, it is too much! This is the second time our only daughter has been grossly insulted!"
Mr. Jameson jammed his hands into his khaki trousers and stared straight at his wife.
"My dear wife, you might as well know how I feel about her artistic tendencies. I agree with Pudge. Just what is that picture supposed to be? She didn't spend 10 minutes doing it, and you call it a work of art. That girl of ours is no genius. She's spoiled."
"Really, Father?" said Jennifer.
"Really, John?"
said Mrs. Jameson. And they both disappeared inside the tent. Pudge spoke up.
"I guess, Mr. Jameson, it would be best if I just didn't bother to come up anymore. I guess having a donkey named Jennifer and a clumsy way of asking questions, it would be best for you if I just didn't bother coming anymore."
And his voice trailed away to a murmur. Slim yawned, trying to be indifferent.
"Yeah, that's about right. I think I better go."
And Chuck and I nodded our agreement.
"Look, boys," Mr. Jameson said, plenty loud enough for his wife and daughter to hear, I'll admit this is somewhat of a problem. I've been busy so many years, I haven't taken the time to get acquainted with my family. I'm surprised and disappointed. And it's really my fault. As far as you boys are concerned, I want you to know that I need you. The way you've helped in the recording of the various birds and the spotting of nests and helping to set up the cameras has been invaluable, and I need you. And besides, boys, and his voice was just a wee bit quieter, I'll tell you something else. I've watched you when you didn't know I was watching, and I've heard you talk. I'm glad to have such clean-cut boys with me. And something else. When you've been here for meals and you took turns praying aloud, thanking the Lord, well, I'll tell you something. It's been 35 years since anything like that happened at my table. It takes me back to when my mother was alive, and it made me remember how she used to pray for me. Pudge spoke.
All right, Mr. Jameson, if you need us like that, we'll come back Monday morning. Tomorrow's Sunday, and we have plans to go over to the village, the church. We'll sort of slip away now and let you folks alone for the rest of the weekend.
We left Mr. Jameson standing, despondently staring at the tent. Petronella ambled lazy-like along with us as we made our way down the trail. Near the end of the trail, a shout drifted up from below. Well, not exactly a shout, but sort of a wheezy snort.
Get you down here, right quick there, boys!
I stared down at the man. He could have been more than 5 feet 2 inches tall. He stood looking up, and with two long skinny arms, he beckoned us in a frenzied, urgent motion.
Get yourself in a hurry, boys! I be wanting to use that there donkey of yours!
As soon as he started to move up the trail, I noticed how bent over and bow-legged he was. Not for a second did he stop crackling away in his high-pitched voice.
I seen your sign down there. Went up to the lodge. Asked for this here taxicab of yours. They said you were a messing with birds. I came up to get ye. Used to be I had to crawl this trail, packing my camping duffel, but no more. Not when there's a four-legged critter to do it. Got important business up here, too. Come on, get a hurry on, boys.
What a sight the little man was. Thin and wiry, with a battered ancient face, bristling with gray whiskers, and a head as bald on top as a tomato, and sunburned about as red, too. As he jabbered on, I almost laughed at the appearance of his mouth, for as near as I could see, he had only one tooth left. His nose tipped upwards with a pushed-into-the-face expression, and shaggy gray eyebrows added to his wild appearance.
"You see, boys,"
he went on, and we hadn't a chance to say one single word as yet.
"I'm getting pretty old. Still, I'm pretty spry, but I want to save my strength for a big job. Yes, sirree, a big job. Which one of ye is Pudge? The one that owns that there critter?"
And he jabbed a crooked finger at Petronella.
"I am. I'll hire her. Give you 35 cents for the trip. Even at that, you're asking quite a bit."
Pudge's mouth dropped wide open.
35 cents? Why, most folks are willing to give $3, and I don't even ask them. 40 cents! 40 cents!
The little man wagged his ancient head back and forth. Then he added,
"And if I find up there what I'm aiming to find, I'll give you 50 cents.
Wow.
"What are you aiming to find?"
Pudge blurted, and then corrected himself.
"What do you expect to find?" "Oh, listen to that there boy asking Jeremiah Quaggins what he expects to find up there."
The pale eyes glared at Pudge.
"I ain't telling you, son."
While this one-sided conversation was rattling on, we had almost reached the bottom of the trail.
40 cents,
Jeremiah Quaggins repeated, and he let his voice drift into a crying wail and dragged each word out to about twice its length.
"I'm a poor man. I ain't got no money, son. Help a poor old man out."
Pudge groaned.
jumping pumpkin seeds. If you're that poor, we'll take your stuff up for nothing.
The wail immediately left the old man's voice.
Ha, 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 he chortled. Old Jeremiah knows how to drive a bargain. He does, he does. Now let's get a hurry in. I want to make camp tonight.
There wasn't a whole lot to load from the boat to Petronella. A few blankets, a 25-pound sack of flour, a fair-sized burlap bag filled with canned food, 5 pounds of sugar, 5 pounds of coffee, a shovel, a pick, and odds and ends of clothes and a pair of beat-up boots. Captain Daly and Pudge's aunt and uncle came down and watched the proceedings. Before long, we were all laughing at Jeremiah Quaggin's babbling.
I said I'd give you 30 cents, and I'm a man that sticks to my word, he said to Pudge as we were about ready to leave. No, I'll do it for nothing.
Jeremiah Quaggin's ignored him.
But I figures that trip up there is worth a mite more. Say 50 cents.
No, Pudge shouted.
Nothing.
But the old man had dug out a leather pouch and was carefully counting out some nickels and pennies.
A dollar I figures ain't too much for a trip like that. So's a dollar you gets. Jumping pumpkin seeds,
Pudge muttered.
Good night, Slim gasped.
All right, a dollar,
Pudge agreed.
A dollar? You steal from an old man like me and take a dollar of my money? What's this younger generation coming to?
And Mr. Quaggin's had himself about crying.
I'll give you 40 cents. All right, Pudge said weakly. Let's go.
The trip up the trail was a riot, with Jeremiah Quaggin's doing absolutely all the talking.
Every year I've been coming up here, every year, but I ain't found it yet.
And he let his voice soften down to a raspy whisper.
Now don't you be asking me what I ain't found. I ain't going to tell you, but I ain't found it. But this year I will.
Just about then, Petronella decided to stop.
Taxi stalled,
Slim chuckled as he headed for a shade under a tree.
I'm for a rest,
Chuck said. Mr. Quaggin's wailed.
Get her moving! I'm in a hurry!
It's no use,
Pudge explained.
We'll have to take 5 minutes rest. You can't budge Petronella.
I can't! I'll just show that knock-kneed hay burner!
And Mr. Quaggin's began to haul away at the halter with no effect on the donkey. He pushed and he pulled, but it was no use. Suddenly, the little man backed off and began to swear. Chuck was on his feet instantly.
Hold on, Mr. Quaggin's. Swearing that like that won't help you.
I always swear when I'm angered, and I'm angered now, so I'm swearing,
the little man screamed. Pudge spoke up.
If you swear anymore, we'll just unload all your stuff right here on the trail.
For the first time since we met him, the little man was silenced. He waddled over and squatted down in the shade with us. Finally, in a squeaky little voice, he said,
don't you boys cuss none?
No, sir.
What do you do when you get mad then?
Slim spoke up. Ask the Lord to forgive us. Chuck broke in.
You see, Mr. Quaggin's, we're Christians. The Lord lives in us.
The little man looked flabbergasted.
The Lord lives in ye?
That's right, Chuck explained. The Bible tells us that when a man turns to the Lord and asks the Lord to forgive his sins, the Lord does it. Then the Lord comes right into that life.
It never happened to me.
And I could see the old man just didn't believe Chuck.
Well, it's happened to us, Chuck said with confidence. Maybe it's hard to explain, but I remember when I asked the Lord to clean up my life.
Did he?
The old man questioned.
Yes, sir, Chuck replied. And swearing was one of the things he took away from me, too.
The old man was silenced.
Pudge scrambled to his feet. Okay, Jennifer Petronella, he said lovingly. Let's move.
And he gently pushed against the donkey's nose. The donkey, in turn, pushed against Pudge and started up the trail. The rest of the trip was uneventful. Jeremiah Quaggin's set up camp a half a mile to the west of the Jameson camp. Dusk was closing in when we made our way down the trail. Pudge, as usual, was excited.
I'd sure like to know what that old man is up to. Whoo! He's a strange one. He's a mystery man. That's what he is. A mystery man.
Around the table that night, we described our adventures to the folks.
Well, Captain Daly smiled, you can take a day off from your adventures, for tomorrow we're going over to town and spend the day. I understand there's a fine little church over there, and we'll stay over for both morning and evening services.
The next chapter is called Jennifer is Missing.
Oh, Jennifer. Which Jennifer? Is it white?